The Blythe Girls, Helen, Margie, and Rose by Laura Lee Hope. The Blythe Girls, Helen, Margie, and Rose. Chapter 1. Uprooted.
Well, here we are.
Rose Blythe, fair-haired, blue-eyed, and pretty, sat down upon one of the several upturned trunks and looked about her disconsolately. The apartment was littered with luggage and personal belongings, for as far as she could see down the vista of hall that ended abruptly and unpleasantly in a small and dingy dining room. Everywhere was disorder and confusion, the inevitable result of a hasty moving. The moving men had been in a tremendous hurry, she thought resentfully. They might at least have waited to put some of the things in order. This reflection proved, beyond a doubt, two things. That Rose was just turned 16 and that she had never before experienced the unpleasant business of moving.
Well, here we are, she repeated gloomily.
And her sister Margie, who had been superintending the placing of a bundle of umbrellas on top of the swathed and utterly disguised piano, turned to her younger sister with a sympathetic smile.
Cheer up, child, she said in the cheery tone that always seemed to be hiding a laugh. It really isn't as bad as you look. Just wait till we get things straightened out a bit. You won't know the place.
Margie Blythe was only a year and a half older than Rose, but she seemed more than that. Perhaps it was her dark hair that made the difference. Or perhaps it was only the fact that she was, by nature, practical and clear-thinking, acting often as a check upon her more temperamental sister. Helen, the third and oldest of the Blythe girls, came in from a last conference with the moving men.
"They are gone," she announced, sinking down upon an immense old couch that seemed far too large for the tiny dining room. "And most of our money has gone with them, too. I never knew moving was so expensive."
"Well, if we have enough left to buy us an evening meal, you had better stand and deliver at once, my dear," said Margie, reaching energetically for her hat. But Rose had crushed her own small straw upon her golden curls and had already possessed herself of the family pocketbook.
"I'll go, Margie," she announced, glad enough to be away from the disheartening confusion for a little while. "You stay with Helen and rest a while."
"Oh, yes, we'll rest," said Margie ironically, while Helen called anxiously after the youngest.
"Don't bring in pickled pig's feet and potato salad the way you did last time, Kitty. We want something filling, you know."
"Sure, roast pork, baked apples, potatoes, green peas, and peach pie," returned the youngest irrepressibly.
"As a little provider, I'll tell you right now, I'm there."
"Whew! Now, who may you be?" This last remark was addressed to a young man who stood in the doorway of the apartment, dangling a curious-looking object in his hand. Upon closer inspection, Rose recognized the young man as the boss of the moving men, officially known as the office manager of the Reynolds Moving Company, and the curious-looking object in his hand as a vegetable strainer, grown old in the service of the Blythe family.
"Is this for me?" asked Rose,
and at her impish grin, the young man grinned back.
"The men overlooked it," he said, adding with a widening of his grin, "had a notion you might be needing it soon."
And before Rose could properly thank him, he had dodged about and was gone.
"Seems to be of a bashful disposition," Rose confided to her two sisters. "But good looking, I'll say. He's the..."
"Rose Blythe, if you use any more of that horrible slang, I'll ship you right back to Riverdale," Helen threatened, and Rose made a laughing face at her.
"If you think that's a threat, you're mistaken, old dear," she jibed. "It's a promise."
With this, she fox-trotted across the threshold, went out into the hall, blithely slamming the door to behind her. The girls heard her running lightly down the stairs. There was no elevator in the apartment house in which they had sought shelter, and it was a long, long way to the street. The two girls left alone in the tumbled apartment, looked at each other significantly, and Helen sighed.
"Rose is a dreadful problem," she said. "It seems only yesterday that she was a kitty, and now look at her."
"Pretty easy to look at, I should say," retorted Margie briskly, and Helen took her up with unusual vehemence.
"That's just the point," she cried. "If Rose were an ugly duckling, I shouldn't worry. But She's so pretty, and now we're here in New York. She left the sentence unfinished, and Margie looked at her quizzically.
Adrift in a big city, is that it? She asked, and Helen laughed.
Not exactly adrift, as long as we have this apartment to anchor to, she said.
Then she gave a glance of discouragement at the confusion around her.
But isn't it an awful place? She asked.
Well, we won't make it any better by sitting and looking at it, suggested Margie practically. Anyway, the view from the windows isn't so bad.
Margie crossed over to one of the large windows in the living room, and her sister followed, putting an arm around her shoulders. What they saw was, as Margie had said, not so bad. The apartment house in which they had taken refuge was situated on a rather steep rise of ground, and before it was a gently sloping vista of open lots and scattered apartment houses. In a short time, all these vacant lots would be occupied, no doubt, by ugly, sky-towering buildings, but for the present the view, such as it was not greatly obstructed.
"Feel that breeze," said Helen, as a faint puff of air blew the fair hair about her face.
"And listen to that hurdy-gurdy," retorted her sister disgustedly as she leaned farther out the window to get a better view of the wilted-looking musician and his decrepit hand organ. Several children had gathered around and were listening in apparent enjoyment to the tinny strains of the sextet from Lucia, played in modern jazz tempo.
"Anyway, the kiddies are happy," added Margie.
Helen sighed involuntarily as she turned from the window.
"I suppose we had better unpack the dishes first," she said. "If Rose ever gets back with her pork and peach pie, we'll probably need them."
Helen Blythe was a tall, slender girl with a mass of ash-blonde hair, which she wore piled high on her head. She was a great deal like Rose, although not so vivid a type. Whereas her hair was fair, it was very light, almost washed out, while Rose's bobbed curls were a warm gold, seeming in some lights almost red. Although her eyes, like the eyes of her younger sister, were blue, Helen's were dreamy and brooding, while those of the younger girl sparkled with life and vivacity. Helen was the artist of the family. In Riverdale, a small town on Long Island where they had lived for many years, she had been pronounced unusually talented, and a great future had been predicted for her by admiring neighbors and friends. But Helen, though she loved their praise, was far too level-headed to be spoiled by it. She knew that she had a certain amount of talent, and that she loved to paint and draw, but she knew also that it would require years of patient study and effort before she could hope to accomplish anything great. They had been a happy family in the big rambling old homestead with its many rooms and air of comfort. Then their mother had died 3 years before. Helen was very like her mother, who had cherished dreams of an artistic career, and had died with those dreams still unfulfilled. Helen knew, as she thought fondly and longingly of that tall, placid, dreamy-eyed mother, that her art had, after all, found the highest form of expression. She had filled the home with beauty and sunshine and harmony of thought, made it so attractive, so bright and pleasant to them all, that they could not bear to leave it and always went back to it eagerly as the one spot of perfect peace and harmony. Yet her mother had whispered to her in that last hour, when all things seemed to stand still in a breathless, frightened silence, and, as the heart of the home, prepared to take the sunshine with her, had whispered so faintly that Helen could scarcely make out the import of the words.
"Make the most of your talent, dear. Don't let anyone discourage you or turn you aside from your purpose. If you could do what your mother has always dreamed of doing, I think I should be very happy in heaven."
Helen had cried from the depths of a breaking heart.
"Mother, darling, I will try. Oh, I will try."
Then the sunshine had gone, and the dear home was a home no longer, but just a place in which to live. Her father, once so carefree, rollicking, and merry, could not survive long that departure. It was as though a plant, thriving in the light of the sun, had been suddenly transplanted to a dark cellar. Just a year after their mother's death, the Blythe girls had faced each other in the living room of the old house and knew themselves not only motherless and fatherless, but almost penniless. Their father, though a brilliant man and lovable, had never been a financial success. He had made enough for them to live on comfortably, and that he deemed sufficient. He had left a small life insurance, and it was on this that the girls had lived for two of the most miserable years they had known. They had not owned the old homestead. If they had, their problem would have been fairly simple. With the income from the life insurance and what money they could have made by taking small positions in Riverdale, they might have managed to get along comfortably enough. But the home was rented, and the rental seemed alarmingly high to the girls. It had been so large, in fact, that they had not been able to live on the income from their small invested capital and had been forced to see the principal gradually dwindle. Margie, the practical one, had long since urged that they give up the house, which was a, quote, white elephant eating off its head, pack up a few sticks of furniture and move to the city where they could find employment and have a chance of making enough money to live on. Helen, because of her mother, had dreaded giving up the old house, but, at last, had been forced to see the wisdom of Margie's viewpoint. So they had taken stock of their assets, which were few, and their liabilities, which were many, and had found that, after scrupulously paying all they owed, they had enough money to pay the moving men and the first month's rental on a New York apartment. With economy, they might be able to meet expenses, feed and clothe themselves for another month. That was all. They did not dare to think beyond that time. Oh, nonsense, Margie had said in her most optimistic mood. By the end of the month, we shall have scrumptious jobs and be just rolling in money. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2. The Blythe Girls. Helen, Margie, and Rose, by Laura Lee Hope. 2. Problems. The great step had now been taken, the moving was over, and the Blythe girls were fairly set for the great adventure. After much searching and skinning of knuckles, Margie and Helen succeeded in discovering the hiding place of the barrel of dishes, and Margie, seemingly miraculously, drew forth a hammer and tack puller from one of the boxes. "What do you bet they are all broken?" said the latter cheerfully. "I mean the dishes, not my knuckles, although there's an even chance either way," she added ruefully. "You poor dear, let me take a hand now." "There! And you always said I never had any strength." The cover was off, and the dishes that had been packed with such loving care were disclosed. Most of the china had been decorated by their mother, and was priceless to them in consequence. Not one piece was broken, which seemed to them an omen of good luck. Carefully, they transported it to the little cubbyhole of a kitchen behind the dark and dingy dining room. They resolutely kept up a cheerful front while Margie hastily scrubbed down the shelves of an inconvenient cupboard, and Helen washed and wiped the precious china till it gleamed. When the shelves of the closet were freshly lined with white paper and the dishes safely bestowed upon them, the girls felt somehow better and more cheerful. "We have something that looks a little bit more like home anyway," said Margie. "Now for the table linen. Have you any idea where it was packed, Nell?" Helen admitted that she had not the slightest idea, and together they went in search of it. They found it presently and proceeded to set the table. When it was all done, they sat down for a moment to take breath and looked at each other. "The kitty isn't back yet," said Helen, voicing the thought of them both. "Now, where do you suppose she can be?" A door slammed noisily at the end of the hall, and Rose herself answered the question. She came into the room, flushed and bright-eyed, to meet a reproach from Helen. "You must try not to slam doors like that, Rose," she said. "We are not in a house all by ourselves now, you know, and the other tenants might object if we made too much noise." "Sort of like being in jail, isn't it?" queried Rose, with a grin that tried to be cheerful but deceived no one. "All right, I'll try to remember, Nell. Now, look here and see what I brought you. Isn't this ever so much better than stodgy old roast pork?
She undid the parcel in her hands and proudly displayed its contents. The girls watched with dismay as she extracted 3 large pickles, some indigestible-looking celery salad, a chunk of highly seasoned meatloaf, and some of the greasiest donuts it had ever been their bad fortune to look upon. Even Margie was disgusted this time, and slapped on a hat over her disordered hair to go out and get some, quote, regular food.
"Well, of all the old fogies!" exclaimed Rose, as the door closed after her disgruntled sister. "What's the matter with this dinner, I'd like to know? It's good and nourishing, isn't it?"
"Yes, and indigestible," said Helen wearily. "I do wish you would use a little more judgment, Kitty."
"And I do wish you would stop calling me Kitty," said Rose, suddenly vehement. "It sounds so silly, especially since I'm almost grown up."
A few minutes later, Margie arrived with some lamb chops and peas, and it was not long before a pleasant aroma was wafting its fragrance through the dingy and disorderly rooms. They ate, too. Oh, how they ate, with the ravenous appetites of young folks who have gone without sustenance for an unusually long period. After they had eaten, they cleared up the dishes with a little more enthusiasm and set to work getting the beds ready for the night. This was not such an easy task, since both the big double bed and the cot, which was to accommodate Rose, were leaning against the wall in the living room, with a small army of bundles and boxes piled against them. When the big bed had finally been set up in the larger of the 2 cubbyholes that must answer for bedrooms, the mattress unearthed and dragged into its proper resting place upon the springs, the bedding found and sorted, the girls were about ready to drop with fatigue.
"And we still have that old cot to move," cried Rose, as she flung herself upon the bed, kicked off one shoe, and rubbed a painful instep. "To tell the truth, I'd rather hang up on a peg all night than budge again."
"Poor Kitty," said Helen, looking pityingly at the bundle of discontent curled up on the foot of the bed.
"You don't have to budge. Just get in your nightie, and we'll have the cot ready in a jiffy." "You are just spoiling that girl, Nell," said Margie in a low tone, as she and Helen went back for the cot. "You shouldn't wait on her like that. She could be getting out the bed linen. We none of us feel as fresh as the morning, you know."
At last, everything was in readiness. The doors and windows were all locked, the lights all out, and nothing remained but to cuddle into bed and sleep. But they did not sleep. Over fatigue, the strangeness of their surroundings, anxiety about their future, all combined to keep them wakeful and restless during the greater part of the night. It was hot, too, breathlessly hot and stuffy in their little cubby holes, where the only air that entered their windows was through an open court. Somebody in the apartment below them was having a late party, playing jazz upon a player piano, whose syncopated rhythm jarred unbearably upon their taut nerves. It was horrible, a nightmare of sights and sounds and smells that assailed their senses and made them long achingly for the rambling old homestead in Riverdale, where there was nothing to break the stillness but the song of crickets and the croaking of frogs in the pool behind the house, where a soft, flower-scented breeze made bearable even the hottest nights. It was nearly dawn before any of them fell asleep, and the sun was high in the heavens before they opened heavy eyes upon the problems of a new day.
"Isn't the noise awful?"
asked Margie, as she sat upon the edge of the bed, swinging a listless foot. "I feel as though I have had to shout to make you hear it all." Helen brushed her hair thoughtfully and nodded.
"It wouldn't be so bad if we were not on a streetcar line."
"And in that case, we would have had to pay just twice as much for this flat as we are doing," said Margie. Then she added with a humorous twist of her mouth, "And if you can tell me how on earth that could be managed, I'll be very proud of you, Helen Blythe."
"And I," said Helen, with a wry smile at her reflection in the mirror, "would be very proud of myself."
End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of The Blythe Girls, Helen, Margie, and Rose, by Laura Lee Hope. 3. The Strainer Man.
After breakfast, which consisted of scrambled eggs, burnt toast, and not very excellent coffee, Helen called a council in the living room.
"We have to decide what we're going to do, girls, and then do it as quickly as possible."
"It seems to me it will be a great deal easier to decide what we're going to do than to do it," said Rose, sitting cross-legged on the couch and munching at one of the very greasy donuts she'd brought home the night before. "If all you read in the paper is true, there are a great many more girls wanting jobs than there are jobs to go around. If you begin your career by believing all the papers say, I certainly feel sorry for you," remarked Margie roundly. Then she said, as her eyes fell upon the partially devoured donut, "I wish you'd put down that horrible thing, Rose. It makes me sick just to look at it." "I am putting it down, the right way," chuckled Rose. "And as long as it only makes me sick, you should worry. But go on, Nell. You were saying something, weren't you?"
"I thought I was," retorted Helen dryly. "And I think you had better not take this matter so lightly, Rose. It really isn't anything to laugh about."
"Well, you don't see me laughing, do you?" protested Rose, her mouth full of donut. "To tell you the truth, I am just about ready to burst into tears, only that I know it would ruin my complexion."
"Not half as much as that donut will," laughed Margie, adding seriously as she turned back to Helen, "You were right about our deciding at once what we're going to do, Nell. You will stay home here, of course," she added decidedly, "and keep house for us and go on with your art. As for me," she hesitated doubtfully, "I can use the typewriter, and I know a little bit about stenography."
"Oh, you're in luck, Margie Blythe," cried Rose,
abandoning her cross-legged position on the couch and speaking eagerly.
"Stenogs draw down tremendous salaries, and with your brains and looks and everything, it won't be any time at all before you get to be a private secretary. And then your boss, he's sure to be a millionaire, will fall in love with you."
"I suppose he won't have anything else to do," agreed Margie, dryly adding with a chuckle,
"You forget, Rose, that it's only in storybooks that the employer is young and handsome. Probably my boss, if I'm lucky enough to get one, will be a crabbed old body, blind in one eye and with chronic indigestion."
"What difference would that make?" said Rose calmly. "If he had plenty of money."
Helen and Margie looked at their little sister in wide-eyed surprise and were about to launch on a lecture when they saw that she was laughing.
"Well, now that I am successfully married off to my wealthy employer," said Margie, turning with a laugh to the still serious Helen, "what shall we do with this little imp here? She isn't really good for anything, except to be spanked."
"What do you want to do, Rose?" asked Helen.
"I'm going to get a store job. They pay pretty good money, and you get good experience if you're willing to start from the bottom and work up."
Rose spoke defiantly, as if expecting opposition, and was ready for it.
"And it's lots of fun, too. You meet so many people and everything," she ended, rather lamely.
The two older girls did not react to this plan, as she had feared they would. They merely exchanged significant glances and then looked long and thoughtfully at Rose.
"Oh, stop staring, do!" the latter exclaimed vehemently, fretted by this prolonged scrutiny. "Really, I'm not a curiosity, only an ordinary girl trying to find the best and quickest way of making money."
"You could study stenography, too. Go to school with me," Margie began slowly, but Rose shook her golden bobbed head emphatically.
"I don't want to go to school. I had enough of it in Riverdale. What I want to do now is to make some real money and see something of life."
"Oh, you'll do that all right," said Margie dryly. "There is one thing about a job in a department store. You certainly do meet people of all kinds."
Helen gave Margie a warning glance and put an arm about her youngest sister.
"It's all right, dear, if you're sure that's what you want to do," she said with an explosive sigh of relief as Rose snuggled closer. "If at any time you want to change to do something else, we can arrange that too. Of course, the most important thing just now is to start the money rolling in."
Rose jumped to her feet, her eyes shining.
"You're a perfect brick, Nell. I thought you maybe wouldn't let me. Oh, dear, where's my hat?"
"Where are you going now?" asked Helen, bewildered, as always, by her sister's abrupt changes of mood.
"To get a job, of course," replied the girl.
But as she charged toward the hall, she was caught and held firmly by the practical Margie.
"Hold your horses, my dear," she drawled. "Do you think jobs grow on trees around here, just waiting to be picked up?"
"Let me go," cried Rose impatiently, but Helen added her voice to Margie's.
"I'll need you at home today, Rose."
And Rose knew that for all of Helen's gentleness, when she spoke in that tone, she generally meant what she said.
"We have to unpack and get to rights, and I couldn't possibly do it all by myself."
"And tonight we will get a paper and look up ads," added Margie, releasing her hold of the crestfallen Rose.
"You have to go about this business systematically, dear. Now be a good girl and take off your hat."
Rose obeyed, flinging the hat among a clutter of boxes in one corner of the room.
"Oh, well, all right," she said sulkily. "If I have to stay in this hole..."
"It's no worse for you than for the rest of us," began Margie heatedly, and Helen hastily assumed her role of peacemaker. Rose was often irritating and capricious, and Margie possessed a temper that got the better of her at times, so that Helen often found it a hard task to keep the peace between the two.
"We haven't said a word about what I am going to do," she reminded them cheerfully. "And as I am not at all sure about it myself, I would welcome suggestions."
Rose said nothing. She had gone over to the window and was sulkily staring down at the busy street. Margie looked at her sister in surprise.
"Why, I thought we had settled all that," she said. "You're to stay at home and keep house for us and go on with your art studies. I should think you would be able to take a course in the afternoon so that you wouldn't have to give up your evenings."
Helen shook her head, and there was an infinite wistfulness in her eyes.
"I should like that, of course," she admitted. "But you know courses cost money."
"Oh, pshaw, the kitty and I will soon be making enough money to put you through a dozen courses, you dear old simpleton," cried Margie gaily.
Then, as she saw that Helen was not fully convinced, she added, "And maybe you'll be able to sell some of your sketches after a while, Nell."
"Say, girls, who do you think is coming?" cried Rose, turning to them, her face all animation again. "It's that good-looking strainer man."
End of chapter 3.
Chapter 4.
The Blythe Girls. Helen, Margie, and Rose by Laura Lee Hope. Chapter 4. The First Day. The two sisters exchanged a look.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.